Now, the problem with the polygenic characteristic is that it will break down if it undergoes recombination with another genotype, which has a different, you know, a polygenic genotype, which is different and has a different characteristic. And so because of recombination, I suggest that a new combination of characteristics in a local population is likely to be temporary, to be ephemeral, and that it will not be registered in the fossil record, and it will not contribute to long-term evolution. Why? Because I suggested that it will be difficult for such a characteristic to spread from the local area where it first originated. And if it does not spread, it will not become abundant enough to be found in the fossil record, and it will not persist through very long periods of geological time. Secondly, it is likely to be unstable. It is not likely to persist very long in a geological time frame, because the population structure under which it first evolved is likely to collapse. And now let me explain both of these possibilities. The first is this, and I was inspired here by thinking about the quaternary, the Pleistocene. And the first observation is that many taxa display niche conservatism. And actually, when climates change, when environments change, they are actually less likely to, populations are less likely to adapt to environmental change than to shift in their geographic position. We see this in the Pleistocene, in which most species in the North Temperate Zone, when it became colder, they did not become adaptive to the cold temperatures. Rather, their geographic range shifted southward toward the equator. And when it again became warmer, instead of remaining in the south of the United States or in Mexico, the entire species range moved northward, following its environment, following the climate to which it was adapted. And so actually the first reaction of many, many species is simply to change the geographic range when climates change, rather than to adapt in situ. Now this, and so for example, here we see an instance of a grasshopper, the saltamonte in Europe, in which we see that during the cold periods, it retreated to several different refuges, and then during the warmer period, since the Pleistocene, it has expanded from these different refuges. And the result, of course, is that any geographic structure in the population which occurred before the glaciation was broken down as those populations became extinct, and the southern parts of Europe instead were colonized. And then you have a recolonization of the northern parts of Europe. And again, this is a reconstitution of populations, often with individuals from many different source populations. And so the result is a high degree of gene flow that can happen when you get the extinction of some populations and the establishment of new populations. This is different from the ordinary level of gene flow that happens in a stable system, where you have a little trickle of gene flow from one population to another. Rather, under these conditions, you can have massive gene flow, which extinguishes the genetic differences between geographic populations. And so you get a collapse of previous population structure, and the result of that is that any divergent local adaptations which had existed would become lost because of recombination between different populations with different characteristics. Now here's the diagram of this happening. Suppose you have had, in some local population, adaptation to a different resource, okay? So you have a red population which achieves a different characteristic from the ancestral type which persists in many other places, adapted to a green resource. But when you have this climatic change, which breaks down the population structure, I'm suggesting that the divergent red populations will become melted together with the persisting gene in the green populations, and the divergent characteristic will be lost. But the divergent characteristic will not be lost if this red adapted population reproductive isolation, which I symbolize here by this bar. That is, the evolution of some characteristic which prevents interbreeding between the locally adapted red population and the more widespread ancestral type green population. So speciation, the formation of reproductive isolation, has the potentiality of stabilizing a new characteristic or a new adaptation which is based on several coadaptive characteristics. Speciation holds them together and prevents them from being lost by interbreeding with the more widespread ancestral form. And therefore, you could have climatic change. And now, instead of one species tracking its resources, tracking its habitat from north to south and back again, you have two distinct species that are able to move independently, that are able to move in the same places, and not hybridize and not break down the differences between them. And so speciation has the consequence of stabilizing new characteristics that might otherwise become lost over the course of time due to a crossing of gene flow between populations that are moving around in space. The other that new characteristics would not be found in the fossil record very often, and that speciation might stabilize them, is that recombination may oppose the initial spread of the character. Suppose that we have two kinds of habitats. We have patches of habitat that are distributed in geographic space. We have purple patches and green and blue patches. And ancestrally, the ancestral type of the species is adapted to the purple patch. Here in one population, in one region where there's a blue habitat, a population becomes adapted, it undergoes genetic change, it has a new polygenic adaptation. And now the question is, can it spread over the landscape to other regions that have this blue habitat type? And that depends very much on the distribution and abundance of blue patches versus purple patches. Because if purple patches are most abundant and larger, then individuals dispersing from a blue patch are likely to disperse into a purple patch, where, of course, they will interbreed with the resident population, which is the ancestral type that is adapted to that kind of habitat. And because the adaptation to the blue habitat is polygenic, these individuals will interbreed by recombination. They will lose their distinctive characteristic, and that characteristic, therefore, cannot be transmitted on to more distant
And therefore, there would be a pattern of
punctuated equilibrium, as Eldridge and Goldman described it, but for a totally different reason than they had supposed. That my hypothesis then does not require anything having to do with founder effect speciation, just normal natural selection, that you know, normal processes that any population geneticist will be happy to agree with. So the question is, do I have any evidence for this hypothesis? And the answer, unfortunately, is that I don't know what evidence to look for other than evidence that would also be supportive of punctuated equilibrium. I would say that there are a couple of ones that are consonant with it. One is we know that there has been a lot of widespread colonization of landscapes from different sources in high gene flow during the Quaternary, during the Pleistocene. We know in some instances that during the period of greatest climatic turbulence, namely the Pleistocene with its interglacial changes, or here in the tropics, it's pluvial, intercluvial changes. We know that some lineages, such as beetles, have shown morphological stasis when you might expect them to be evolving faster. And also, there is some evidence of reduced speciation during the Quaternary, a period of great environmental instability, although there is some argument about this and some contrary evidence. And the second is that there is some evidence that rates of evolutionary divergence are enhanced by speciation. There is remarkably little evidence on this point. Because of course, if you simply have two lineages, and each of them just persists through time, undergoing random evolutionary changes, the variance among them will increase over time. The question is whether further speciation events in each of those two lineages, does that enhance the amount of variance which increases? Does it accelerate the increase in variation among lineages? Because that is what my hypothesis, as well as Eldridge and Gould, would predict. And at this point, I'm aware of only two lines of evidence on this. One is the claim by Martin Pagel and the co-author that there are higher rates of DNA sequence change as a consequence of speciation. And there's some work by Bokoha and colleagues having to do with mammal, you know, the body size, body mass in mammals, which he claims again fits the punctuated equilibrium expectation. Possibly the best evidence that I've seen has not yet been published. This is in press in PNAS, Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, by Vieira, Henson, Steve Arnold, and PNR. And they have analyzed the amount of divergence, this is the amount of change in standard deviations between lineages of mammals with respect to body mass, mammals, birds, and swans, with respect to body mass, as a function of the time interval over which such change is measured. And remarkably, even though we know that you can see sometimes very rapid changes within populations, we can see, you know, just like studying the Darwin finches, we see sometimes very rapid changes in morphology. Nevertheless, changes over short periods of time, such as 100 years or 1,000 years, are, you see no accumulation of change at all. You get the same amount of total change whether you are looking at 10 years or at 10 to the 6th years. Not until you reach a million years do you start seeing an actual accumulation of divergence among lineages and mammals, among species and mammals. And they suggest, the authors, I mean, this is a remarkable observation. It means that there's a lot of evolution going on all the time at the local level, and it's quite rapid, but it doesn't accumulate over time. They say what we're looking at is a failure of local rapid divergence to leave a long-term signature. And they suggest that maybe speciation then is the critical